This morning, we want to continue in our study of the life of Moses. We are in Exodus chapter 20, where the children of Israel are at the base of Mount Sinai. They are receiving what the Jews call the Ten Words, what we commonly call the Ten Commandments from the Lord. And we have looked at six of the previous commandments. Today, we will look at the seventh commandment. And so, if I were to say use a word like fling or thing or carrying on, hanky-panky, extracurricular activity, matinee, and playing around, most folk would understand those to be synonyms for what this seventh commandment condemns. Most folk would know that those are synonyms for adultery. And so in our society, when God calls a sin, here in our modern society, we have decided that we want to use terms to lessen that sin, to cheapen that sin, to make it not as bad as it really is. And so rather than calling it adultery, we call it hanky-panky. It sounds kind of cute. You know, it's got a little ring to it. This one, matinee, threw me for a loop because I looked up synonyms for adultery. Matinee, then it dawned on me. I remember back in the day, for those of us who are in our 40s and above, though I'm in the above category, remember watching the movies and how the guys would meet with a girl in the afternoon and they would go to a hotel in the afternoon, the business owner? That was a matinee. Because, you know, you had the regular movies that start at 6 o'clock. And you got the matinees that start ahead of time. And so maybe when he's home with his wife, that's the regular movie. But in the afternoon, it was the matinee. All right? Yeah, it was cheaper, huh? Some other synonyms that are probably more recognizable to us would be affairs, cheating, immorality, infidelity, two-timing. And those are normally only thrown around when the cheater, the adulterer, has been caught, and somebody says, well, that's immoral. You are a two-timer. You are a cheater. And so we attach that to the individual who is the guilty party in the adulterous relationship. We want to minimize it on one hand, but then when we are the ones who are the innocent ones in the case of adultery, we want to call the other person a bad name. Well, why don't we just stick with what God says? It's called adultery. In the ancient world, adultery was known amongst many of the ancient cultures as the great sin. The great sin. They all recognized that adultery was wrong. The only difference between the other cultures and Israel's culture was that it was Israel's God who spoke to them audibly from a mountaintop. And he told them that adultery is wrong. And he says in Exodus chapter 20, verse 14, very simply, do not commit adultery. Do not commit adultery. This is a negative way in which a positive is being stated. The positive command here would be to have sexual relationships with your partner only. Your married partner only. Now I gotta, because of where we live today, I gotta put it in right terms. It's gotta be a man and a woman. Because in today's economy, two women can get married, two men can get married, five people can get married. So God is saying to the nation of Israel, for a husband and a wife, a man and a woman, do not commit hanky-panky. Don't have a side piece. Don't step out on the marriage. Don't have an affair. No, he said, don't commit adultery. Do not have sexual relationships with someone other than your spouse. And this is for both the male and the female. A wife can't have sex with anyone other than her husband, and a husband can't have sex with anyone other than his wife. That's what adultery is. The verb that's used here in the Hebrew appears some 31 different times in the Old Testament. where it says about do not commit adultery. It is so serious that God even said to the nation of Israel on several occasions when they walked away from him, you have played the harlot, you have committed adultery. I was just reading in my Bible reading this week, reading in Jeremiah, and it was amazing how many times God has said to the nation of Israel, you will commit adultery under this tree, you will here in that grove, you will with this piece of wood, you will with that hunk of stone. God considered worshiping someone and something else other than him for his chosen nation to be a matter of adultery. He said, you're cheating on me. Man. Some commentators suggest that this command to not to commit adultery is inclusive of all sexual sins. Premarital sex, postmarital sex. You say, what do you mean postmarital sex? So that's like widows, that people who have been married and then they are widows, and then for them to have sex with someone else other than their deceased spouse that they're not married to. People said this would involve, this command also includes bestiality, incest, but that's not what God is talking about here. I think they have stretched this command. They've gone beyond that command. They're not doing true exegesis. God simply is saying to Israel, do not commit adultery. So if he's not talking about the premarital sex, which is still wrong, because there are other laws that talk about that. If he's not talking about bestiality, which is wrong, because there are other laws that talk about that. If he's not talking about incest, which is wrong, because there are other laws that address that, then why is it that this law, this term adultery, finds its way in the foundational laws of the nation of Israel? I thought about that and I came up with this conclusion. It's because marriage is the foundation for society. Marriage is the foundation of society. And a husband and a wife have to, they must trust each other. Now, I talk to Barrett folk often. And one of the biggest things that I hear in married relationships is a lack of trust. I keep telling the couples, and I got a couple of them here that I've done premarital counseling with, and I was saying, you know, one of the biggest things that mess up a marriage is a lack of effective communication. That in my opinion, what I hear, is the number one thing. The lack of effective communication. Folk don't know how to talk to each other. We talk at each other. We talk about each other. We talk around each other, but we don't talk with each other effectively. And if you can't communicate with words and emotion and love effectively, then you're not going to trust the person that you're with. I don't know what he's thinking. He don't never say nothing. I know what he's doing. All she ever does is just yell at me. I don't never do nothing right. And that helps to breed distrust. And so when God says, do not commit adultery, he is saying, you need to know how to trust each other. Because if you can't trust each other in your marital relationships, how can you trust throughout all of your societal relationships? Look at our country. Look at where we are right now. There's a lot of infidelity in our country. And I'm not just picking on him because of who he is, but I'm thinking about, as you look at the whole picture, of one of our presidential candidates right now. Been married 3 times, has a long history of infidelity, and yet our nation wants to rally around him and make him our leader. When God says, do not commit adultery. So we want to elect a known and proud adulterer as our president. Something's wrong with that picture. If we knowingly elect one who is a known adulterer, what does that say about our society? How deep, how far can this country move away from God? We've got a current president who says it's okay for 2 men to marry. It's okay for 2 women to marry. So now we want to elect one that says, you can be married to whoever you want to be married to, and then have all your side pieces too, because I did it. And there's a problem, y'all. When the marriage relationship is disturbed, when it is damaged, when it is injured, society becomes damaged and injured and disturbed at the same time. Have you ever thought about how many people abhor, they hate the idea of even the thought of being an adulterer? You ever thought about that? Nobody wants to be called an adulterer. Back in the early years of our country and before we were founded as a country in the 1600s, the 1400s, 1500s, when one was an adulterer and they were convicted of being an adulterer, they had to walk around with an A on their clothes. They had to walk through society telling everybody, I'm an adulterer. They were forced out of the closet. Nobody wants to be known as an adulterer. However, in our society, it is a lesser sin or no sin at all if people have premarital sex. You ever thought about that? It's okay. I love her, he loves me. Now it's just physical. But nobody wants to be known as an adulterer. I thought about that and I was wondering, why is it that no one wants to be known as an adulterer? And I think, and this is just my own thinking, again, I talk to a lot of people. I think it's because people don't want anyone to ruin their marriage. I remember some 20, 25 years ago, actually over 30 years ago now, a coworker I had, he used to work at Norfolk Naval Shipyard, and then he was a security guard in a building in downtown Portsmouth. And he would tell me about his exploits with his side piece while he was working security at night. And I remember looking at him, I said, hey man, let me ask you a question. What if you came home one day and you found your wife in the bed with some other guy? Oh, I'd kill her. Now, it was okay for him to have his girlfriend doing whatever they were doing in all the offices down in City Hall, because that's where he was a security guard. But he would kill his wife. And when I told him, I said, man, but it's just as wrong for you as it is. No, it's okay for me. That in some people's minds, it's okay for men to have side pieces. But it's not right for, I'm just telling you, I mean, because people tell you. I talk to a lot of folk, you know, it's okay for men to do this, but it can't be all right for a woman to do this. Something wrong. It's wrong for both. Remember, when God spoke from that mountaintop, he was talking to every adult, male and female, that was in the nation of Israel. And he was telling them, do not commit adultery. Our society here in America, based upon what we see in our media, and again in my conversations with people, they will say, well, if my husband and I, or my wife and I, are separated, it's okay for me to get a boyfriend or a girlfriend, and for us to have sexual relations, because I am separated. That ring still on your finger? Yes. Is that marriage certificate still in your safe deposit box or on your wall in your house? Yes. But we talking about getting divorced. And y'all been talking about this for the last 10 years. Well, I got to have some companionship. God calls it adultery. No, but we separated. God calls it adultery. No, we're separated. God calls it adultery. And so people have to understand. And if we don't hold a standard, who will? And God was telling Israel, even though the other nations around you hate adultery, I'm telling you I hate it, and I am the true and living God. I am your God, and you should never do it under any circumstances. Would you believe that this commandment has the same grammatical structure as the one that precedes it? Remember a couple of weeks ago we were talking about never murder? This has the same grammatical structure. And that's what God said, never commit adultery. But she got on my nerves. He stepped out on me, and so now I got to repent. Never commit adultery. She won't give me none. Oh, well. I'm sorry, it sounds a little raw, doesn't it? But I was looking at, and I can't recall all of them, but I was looking at an article in Women's World, or Women's Day, whatever it is, about why men cheat. And something that stood out in that really rang with me, and it surprised me. And they said that most men don't cheat because they are unhappy at home. That's not it. They just cheat. What it is, it may be that there's, and watch this, ladies, and I'm not putting this on you, but a lot of it is still emotional. For many men, sex is nothing but a physical thing. That's why women call men dogs, because they can go from this woman to that woman to that woman to that woman. You know, it's not that much of an emotional attachment for most men. But with a woman, there's this emotional attachment. But with a woman, there's an emotional attachment when it comes to sex. And so when we see shows like Scandal and what's the one on BET, Mary Jane or whatever else, where these women are the ones who are supposedly in control of their lives and in control of who they sleep with, whether married or single, you will watch those characters, because when they're all by themselves, those females are still wondering about, did I do the right thing? I gave myself, I'm in control, supposedly, but no, you're not in control because your emotions are still attached. And you're wondering what Shakima did over here with your man that you just slept with. You want to say it didn't matter? Yes, it does matter. And there are men, there are many men who still have this emotional attachment. Every time a man has sex with a woman, he has this in his mind. And keep this in mind, ladies, he has in his mind that he owns you. He may not say it, but he feels that he owns you. That's why men put notches on their belts. And so when some men get married, they still got to put notches on their belts rather than being satisfied with the one they've chosen. I sat in this very room yesterday for a wedding. And they said to each other, "Till death do us part. Forsaking all others." You cannot forsake all others and have a side piece. That's not forsaking all others. So what's the problem? What's the damage? What's the harm of adultery? Let me give you three things that I can see that would be harmful, or what happens because of adultery. Number one, adultery damages and betrays the emotional and psychological intimacy of marriage. When adultery has occurred in a marriage, whether it's on his part or her part, there's always going to be some kind of upheaval in the psychology and the emotional stability of that marriage. And I have counseled many of men who have gone through adultery. They've done it themselves, and they say, "Man, I don't know. I said, "Let me tell you something, brother. I don't know how long this is going to take, but it's going to take a while. You're going to be walking on eggshells in your house. It's going to happen. If you want to repair this, then you need to let her know where you are at all. But I'm a man." Okay. You created this mess. You came to me and asked me how to help. Well, I'm trying to tell you how to help. To maintain her psychological and her emotional stability, she needs to know where you are at all times. If you say you come home at 5 o'clock every day, it's 5:01, you better be walking through that door. "Man, that ain't fair." Well, what you did was not fair. That's just the way it is. You find yourself, you're going to be 2 minutes late because you got a cell phone, you call her, you text her. How long I got to do this? Until she tells you she trusts you? Until she says, "You don't have to do that anymore," because you've proven to her. You've removed a lot of that pain and damage to her psyche. What's the second harm of adultery? It threatens the stability of the family as designed by God. One man, one woman, for one lifetime. That's God's structure. One man, one woman, for a lifetime. Well, I want more. Well, then you don't want to obey God. And there are Christians who think it's okay to every now and then go get you some. Go get you some strange. I'm telling you, I talk to a lot of people. In the church, in your choirs, on your deacon boards, in your pulpits, serving as ushers on your doors. It's okay every now and then. I don't understand where never commit adultery means it's okay every now and then. The third damage that I see about adultery is it cheapens the institution of marriage, causing it to be reduced to a simple contract between a man and a woman, a husband and a wife, rather than being a lifelong and life-binding covenant. Contracts are designed to get out of. Contracts are designed to be broken. Covenants are designed to stay in for the length of that covenant. And every covenant that's in the Bible, every covenant of the ancient world, it was a lifelong binding covenant. It's an agreement, and the only way out of this is that I gotta die. That's why our world today, this is why our nation is today can say two men and two women can get married, because it's just a contract in their eyes. And when adultery occurs, it cheapens, it lessens, it eradicates the idea of a covenant. Nobody really wants to think about permanence, I think, today. I'm in it for what I can get out of it, not what I can bring to it. And that's what marriage is all about. What do you bring to the table? Now, I know some of you may be thinking, well, you look in the Old Testament and you see where Abraham had two wives, his sons had multiple wives, David had wives, Solomon had 999 extra wives than the one that he had. Sure. Well, the Bible allowed polygamy, but let me point this out to you. In my studies, here's the thing that really tripped me out was this. Even though the Bible tolerated polygamy, God's ideal has always been one woman for one lifetime, right? In a single marriage. But the culture of that time was that we could have multiple, watch this now, wives. And so in a polygamous marriage, you still had a wife. You didn't just have a side piece. You had a wife, which meant that the husband had to be economically and emotionally supportive of the X number of wives he had. Now, don't get me wrong. I don't want y'all to start going like that boy on TV and start having a whole bunch of sister wives. That ain't what I'm saying here. That's not the point I'm making. Because economically, I just got the one. Because I never understood that. With all the men that I've been around my whole life, and I've known many men who have cheated, I'm like, how in the world can this dude take care of home? And he's got this girlfriend and that girlfriend and that girlfriend. Where does he get the money? And then it hit me one day. That dude is working 12 hours a day, 7 days a week at Norfolk Naval Shipyard. That's how he's got them all. And then I got to thinking, well, if he's working here 7 days a week, 12 hours a day, when is he get a chance to see all these girlfriends he's got? And you can't support but so many women emotionally. I have a hard time with the one I got. And I love her dearly. I don't know what Solomon was thinking. You got 1,000 different personalities you got to deal with. And I guess because he was the king, because he was the king, he didn't have to see him but so many times, you know, once every 5 or 6 years. But you got to put up with this. You can't do that. Now, how do you name all them children? How do you remember all those children? The Bible even regulated polygamy. Turn with me to Deuteronomy chapter 21. Deuteronomy chapter 21. Even though God tolerated it, it wasn't his ideal, and God allowed it to happen in the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, laws actually regulated some of the ways that, or some of the actions in polygamy. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 21 and look at verse 15. Moses is giving the law to the children of Israel here, and he says, if a man has two wives, one loved and the other unloved. See this emotional attachment here? That's not there that should be. And they have borne him children, both the loved and the unloved. And if the firstborn son is of her who is unloved, then it shall be on the day he bequeaths his possessions to his sons that he must not bestow firstborn status on the son of the loved wife in preference to the son of the unloved, the true firstborn. So it's not just the woman's emotional attachment. Now it's the man's emotional attachment. I've got two wives. I love wife B better than I do wife A, but wife A gave me the firstborn son. So all of my possessions are supposed to go to the firstborn son of wife A. But I don't like her. And so I don't want her son or her to have nothing. In my own mind, I think that she is my possession. I can do what I want to do with my possessions, her son. But God says, you can't go against the law of the Levirate, which is to pass down the right inheritance of the right child. You can't do that, the law of the firstborn, I should say, just because you have a preference. You got to do it right. Look at verse 17. But he shall acknowledge the son of the unloved wife as the firstborn by giving him, here it is, a double portion of all that he has. For he is, that firstborn son is the beginning of that husband's, of that man's strength. The right of the firstborn is his. So God has some laws that regulated polygamy. There's only one law that I could find in the Old Testament that prohibited polygamy. Look in Deuteronomy chapter 17. And while you're turning there, keep in mind that polygamy was not just where a man could have multiple wives. Polygamy also speaks of a woman having multiple husbands. Yeah. There are some cultures where a woman can have as many husbands as she wants. I don't know how many men are going to go with that. Not American men anyhow. But if that's the culture in which you were raised, it seems normal and natural to you. In Deuteronomy chapter 17, Moses is telling the children of Israel against some various laws, but he's also telling them about when they get a king. So look at verse 17. Listen, look at what the Lord says in verse 17 of Deuteronomy 17. He's talking about when Israel gets a king, and he's putting prohibitions upon the king. And one of the prohibitions was, neither shall he marry multiple wives for himself, lest his heart turn away, nor shall he greatly multiply silver and gold for himself. So when they selected a king, when you read previously, you see he's not supposed to have multiple horses and all this other stuff. But he says he's not supposed to have multiple wives. And God gives a reason for that. What's the reason? Lest his heart turn away. Let's go back now to King David. Let's go to David's son Solomon. And the Bible clearly says it's about Solomon. Solomon loved many women, and they turned his heart away from God. God told him in the law and prophesied in the law what would happen. There's no way that you can serve more than one person, more than one woman, more than one man, and try to serve God at the same time. It is impossible. You can't do it. In the New Testament, Paul reiterates, Paul and Jesus both, they reiterate God's ideal. In 1 Corinthians chapter 7, which is that marriage chapter, verse 2, Paul, in verse 1, Paul talks about it's good for a man not to touch a woman. But in verse 2, That don't mean you can't hold hands. I know what he's saying. It's the sexual connotation. He says it's good for a man not to have sex with a woman, particularly when they're not married. But listen to what he says in verse 2 of chapter 7 of 1 Corinthians. Nevertheless, because of sexual immorality, let each man have his own wife, and let each woman have her own husband. You got to have your own wife. You got to have your own husband. He didn't say anything about having anybody on the side. He didn't say anything about concubines. You got to have your own wife and your own husband. For what reason? So that you don't have sexual immorality. And let me say this while I'm thinking about it, because I might forget it. I'm getting older now. Things come and go. Over the years, I've encountered many women who have been the side piece. Many women who have been the side piece. And they think that it's okay to date a married man. And I have seen each of them suffer emotionally, deeply, because they pine for this dude who is no good enough to have you on the side. And they beg of him to marry her. And he gives a lot of these false promises. Well, I'm going to leave her at some point. I'm going to leave her at some point. And never leaves. And she's longing for him. And she hangs into this relationship for 10, 15, 20 years. Some longer than that. They've been the side piece for that long. And their own self-worth just drops right down. Oh, yeah, he shells her money. He pays her bills. He helped put her children through college. And what I'm about to say is going to sound rough, but she's been no more than a prostitute for all those years. That's all she's been. She has sold herself. George said it right. For service is rendered. She wants him, but she feels bad about herself. So let every man have his own wife. Let every woman have her own husband. It hurts my heart when I see women who are in these relationships, and I wonder, what are you doing, lady? What are you doing, baby? What are you getting out of this? Because this man comes to your house, you got to cook him dinner, and he's got to leave at 2 o'clock in the morning. What do you get out of this? Maybe what some women say is true. I know it isn't, but I can see why they say it. All men are dogs. But a dog lays down with another dog. Hear what I just said? A dog mates with another dog. And women hate that B word. But if you're the side piece, what are you? If he's a dog, what are you? Tell your girlfriends. Tell your daughters. Tell your nieces. Get a husband. Your own husband. Tell your sons, tell your nephews, tell your friends, get a wife, your own wife, and keep her. You won't ever be characterized as being a dog. The idea of one wife for one husband is so serious that when we read in Timothy and in Titus, the qualification for church leaders, Paul tells those two young preachers in setting up the church, the church leaders, the pastors and the deacons, they are supposed to be the husband of just one wife, not having a polygamous relationship. Now, in the Greek, that comes out to be a one-woman man. That's basically what it means. But what do you mean by one-woman man? You don't have more than one woman. You just only have one woman. That's the way it is. In the ancient world, when a polygamist was converted to Christianity, they weren't always told to divorce all but one wife. There were some who thought that that was the way to go. But because of the family structure, most of the time, they were allowed to stay in their polygamous relationships because the idea of divorce was worse than him being a polygamist. The idea of those children that were a result of that polygamous relationship or that polygamous marriage and those children being cast out and having no support was worse than this guy having two or three wives. I'm not saying it's right or wrong. That's just the way it is. Let's take a look at what Jesus said in several places when it comes to adultery. One of the first things that we find that Jesus says that you can be turning to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. That Jesus makes it plain that adultery is not just a physical act. He says it's a matter of the heart and the mind. It's a matter of the heart and the mind. In Matthew chapter 5, I want to start reading at verse 27. Matthew 5, 27. Jesus is in his Sermon on the Mount, and he says to them, "You have heard that it was said to those of old, 'You shall not commit adultery.'" I wonder where he got that from. Verse 28 says, "But I say to you, that whoever looks at a woman to lust after her, to have burning desire for her, to want to get with her, that's undressing her with his eyes, has already committed adultery with her in his heart." It's a done deal. Jesus says, if you lust after this woman, it's a done deal. You have already committed adultery. So what's the remedy? He says, well, if your right eye causes you to sin, pluck it out and cast it from you. For it is more profitable for you that one of your members perish than for your whole body to be cast into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and cast it from you, for it is more profitable for you that one of your members perish than for your whole body to be cast into hell. Just one little member of a man's body can get him in trouble. Y'all know the old saying, thinking with the wrong head. One little member can have your whole body cast into hell, is what Jesus is saying. And it starts not just with that body part, it starts up here in your head and in your heart. I got to be careful because I love beautiful women. I ain't going to lie to you. I love to see beautiful women, but I know I can't look but so long. And every man in here is probably just in the same boat that I am. Okay? I look. That's a nice dress. Yesterday when we were at the wedding reception, and I told Sheila, I said, that's a nice looking sundress, because I think it was the nurse from her school had on a sundress. And the way that it was designed, I said, that's a nice, she said, oh yeah, that's a nurse. Okay, good, no problem. It wasn't no problem because the girl knew Sheila. It's no problem because I won't look at her in a sexual way. I'm like, they just look nice. There's nothing more beautiful in this world than a well-appointed woman. Nothing. And she don't have to have it so real tight. She don't have to have it so short. She doesn't have to have it so high and cut so low. And no, you know, You put a woman in a nice dress and she's carrying herself like a woman. Ain't nothing more beautiful than that in this world. And I can say that, but I can't go after her. I can't let my mind go, well, I wonder. When you get to that point that I wonder, you have gone too far. And I don't know too many men is going to be plucking out their eyes. And you know what? It is not hard to pluck out an eye. It's very simple to do. You put enough pressure right here, it'll pop right out. It don't take a whole lot of pressure either. Y'all didn't know that, did you? Yeah, it will hurt. It will hurt. Jesus also said when it comes to adultery, he says that if a husband divorces his wife and he marries another, he commits adultery. Now, we need to look at a few passages in total before I can explain this. So we're going to look at Luke chapter 16. Look at Luke 16. Luke 16, 18. Because this has been a source of contention or debate in Christendom when it comes to divorce and remarriage. So we need to take a look at what Jesus is actually saying here, all right? So look at Luke 16, 18. Jesus says, whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery. And whoever marries her who is divorced from her husband commits adultery. Without any comment, just let's go to the next one. Let's go to Matthew 5. We're going back to Matthew 5 where we were. Matthew 5, 31 at this point. Matthew 5, 31. All right, Matthew 5, 31. Jesus again is speaking. Furthermore, it has been said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that whoever divorces his wife for any reason except sexual immorality causes her to commit adultery. And whoever marries a woman who is divorced commits adultery. Now, what Matthew does is Matthew helps to clarify what Luke recorded. Matthew was there when Jesus said these words. So he records everything that Jesus said. Luke only recorded a part of what Jesus said. All right? So listen again to what Matthew says, that Jesus said. Whoever divorces his wife, let him, he said, you have heard it said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. Under the Jewish economy, even though God did not intend for divorce to happen, he allowed it to happen. And so a man could divorce his wife under the Jewish law, not God's law, not the Mosaic law, but the rabbinical law. A man could divorce his wife for any reason. Some of you have probably heard Dr. J. Vernon McGee say he could divorce his wife for burning the biscuits. All right. And so what Jesus says is, you've heard that you can do this. You can divorce for any reason. He says now in verse 32, but, here's that contrasting conjunction, but I say to you, whoever divorces his wife for any reason except, there's only one reason Jesus is saying that you can divorce her, is sexual immorality. The Greek word porneia, which is a broad spectrum, it's a broad word. The antibiotic that I am taking for this sinus infection, the pharmacist said, look, this is penicillin, but there are some other things that are in this penicillin, some other additives in this antibiotic that's a broad spectrum. So it's designed to attack all kinds of bacteria that may invade your body. So when Jesus uses the word porneia here, he says it's a broad term. It's not just if she commits adultery. Porneia includes adultery, incest, bestiality, homosexuality, anything you can think of that is sexually wrong, that's included in this term, sexual immorality, the Greek word porneia. If you're going to have sex with your cat, if you're going to have sex with your nephew, you're going to, you know, Jesus said, all of this is wrong. That's a reason for divorce. So if you divorce her for any other reason other than sexual sins, then what does he say? The man causes his wife to commit what? Adultery. I got to answer for my own sins. Why would I do something that's going to cause somebody else to sin, and then I got to answer for being the cause for that person to sin? And not just her, but the person whom she marries, because I put her away for a non-biblical reason. So she's going to be committing adultery, and the guy who marries her is going to be committing adultery, because it was not a biblical reason for divorce. So Jesus says the only reason for divorce is for what? Sexual impurity. All right? Now go with me to Mark chapter 10, and this is a lengthy passage. Mark chapter 10. Excuse me. Mark 10:1. Then he, speaking of Jesus, arose from there and came to the region of Judea by the other side of Jordan, and multitudes gathered to him again. And as he was accustomed, he taught them again. The Pharisees came and asked him, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" And Mark says they were testing him. And he said to them, "What did Moses command you?" They said, "Moses permitted a man to write a certificate of divorce and to dismiss her." Out of here, be gone. Verse 5. Jesus answered and said to them, because of the hardness of your heart, he wrote you this precept. But from the beginning of the creation, God made them male and female. And I don't care what our Supreme Court says, you can't get around that. This is the word of God here. God made them male and female. For this reason shall a man, a male, leave his father, a male, and mother, a female, and be joined with his wife, who is a female. Two men can't produce children. Well, yeah, they can go adopt somebody. They can freeze their sperm and put in the sperm bank, but they didn't do it the way God ordains it. All right? Verse 8, and the two shall become one flesh. So then they are no longer two, but one flesh. Here's verse 9. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no man separate. Now, look at verse 10. Here's where I really want to get to. In the house, his disciples asked him again about the same matter. They were like, "Lord, what's up with this? What are you saying here?" And he said to them, "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits," watch this now, "commits adultery against whom?" So when we look at the previous passage, it's almost like the guy can divorce his wife and she's going to be committing adultery, and the guy that marries her will be committing adultery, and the husband that did the divorcing was scot-free. But Mark makes it plainer than what Matthew made it. If I put Sheila away and it's not for sexual immorality, and I go out here and I get married again, I commit adultery against Sheila. Does it make sense to y'all? You think marriage is serious to God? Do you think that the sanctity and the purity of marriage is serious? Yes, it is. So nobody gets away when it comes to adultery. That's the point I want you to see. Nobody gets away. And then in verse 12, just so you don't think it's just on the man's part, if a woman divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery. And again, it's based upon if she divorces her husband, you know what, he just don't pay me no attention. All he want to do is sit there and play those video games. And then you want to get rid of him just because he plays video games? I'm gonna get rid of him. Does he bring his money home? Yeah. Does he have a girlfriend? No. Does he take care of the babies? Yes. And you're gonna divorce him over video games? I wish I could talk to her. And I know guys get wrapped up in these video games. I understand that. But there's an easy way, there's an easy fix for that. Don't pay the electric bill for 3 months. Get the electricity cut off. Now y'all got to sit here in the dark with a candle, cook on the grill in the backyard, and learn how to talk to each other. No, that's not. Yeah. just so that you will know how serious God viewed marriage and how serious he viewed divorce, turn with me to Leviticus 20. Leviticus 20. In Leviticus chapter 20, verse 10, God is expanding now or giving the penalty for many of the laws if they were broken. In Leviticus 20:10, God says, the man who commits adultery with another man's wife, he who commits adultery with his neighbor's wife, the adulterer and the adulteress shall surely be put to death. What's the penalty? Death. Who's going to be penalized? Both the adulterer and the adulteress. And so when we see TV shows like Devious Maids, Mistresses, Scandal, all these folks jumping in and out of bed with married folk and they married, there'd be a lot of dead people in America. As we have a tendency to glamorize sin. And those of us who are born again, who are blood washed in Jesus' blood, who have the Bible as our God, we can't let this stuff start to change our perspective on right and wrong. And as I said before, you've got many people in churches, not in this one, at least I hope, not in this one, who think that adultery is okay occasionally. There are sex therapists, relational therapists who are telling them, yeah, you need to step outside the marriage every now and then just to keep things fresh. I heard my mama mumbling something, and being at 84, I'm sure it was probably something very wise. I don't know exactly what she said. I don't get it. And don't get me wrong. I cannot stand here and honestly say to you, in nearly 38 years of marriage, that my mind has never wondered. And I would almost bet that all of you who are married here, your mind has wondered at some point. And I'm gonna say, I didn't say wander, I said you have wondered. I can't tell you there's never wondered, because there are so many factors that affect us. And if we're not prayed up, we're not read up, we're not close with the Lord, not only will we wander, we may wind up wandering. Okay? Can't say that I've never wondered, but what keeps coming back to mind is the foundation of the Word of God that was placed in me as a child, and that I read on a daily basis, and that I have to preach and teach on a weekly basis. And God says, never commit adultery. I don't care what my flesh wants to do. That's why the Bible tells us, Paul says, I beat my body daily. I gotta fight this thing. Because your body will tell you to do something else. Your mind will tell you to do something else. Society will tell you to do something else. And you know what we do? We talk to folk under the pretense of, let me get your guidance on this. What do you think about this? You know what we're looking for? We're looking for someone who's going to concur with what we're thinking, with what we're feeling. We want somebody to tell us, it's okay to do. Just so long as Sheila don't know. What she don't know won't ever hurt her. In that article I was mentioning to you in Women's Day, Women's World, one of the things that they said in the article was this, that every woman knows when her husband is cheating. She may be in denial. She may want to not want to give credence to it. She may want to say, well, maybe not. They say every woman knows when her husband is cheating. Let me give you some stats. I'm going to close with this. The Associated Press Journal of Marital and Family Therapy, on January 1st, 2015, conducted this survey. It was a survey dealing with infidelity. And these are the results of their survey. The percentage of marriages where one or both spouses admit to infidelity, either physical, watch this now, they classify, either physical or emotional, 41% of respondents said in their marriage there has been infidelity, physically or emotionally. 57% of men admit to committing infidelity in any relationship. Women ain't much better. 54% of women admit to infidelity in any relationship. Used to be a time, I think, when women felt sorry for other women, and they would say, well, if I were married, I wouldn't want that to happen to me, so I'm not going to be his side piece. Today, there are a lot of women that want nothing but to be a side piece. Some women do it out of spite. I ain't never liked her, no way. 22% of men admitted to have strayed at least once during marriage. 14% of women admitted to have strayed at least once during marriage. 36% of both men and women admitted to an affair with a coworker. This has just been 18 months ago, y'all, or 17 months ago. 17% of men and women admit to an infidelity with a brother or sister-in-law. Yeah, you're going to get somebody killed.
Yeah.
All that stuff you see on Jerry Springer and Maury, you ain't seen nothing to the real stuff come to light. Those are stage fights. The average length of an affair is 2 years. 2 years. That's just crazy. Here's a kind of encouraging statistic. 31% of marriages lasted after a discovered or an admitted affair. And I point that one out as encouraging because with so many people that I talk to, I can tell you I know of a lot of marriages that have survived adultery. Adultery does not have to wind up in divorce. It doesn't have to. But it takes work. It takes a lot of toil for that marriage to work. And so you got to have a mindset. Sitting back over there during the wedding yesterday, I was sitting beside one of Sheila's co-workers, and when she found out that we had been married for 30 years, she asked me, she said, what's the secret? She said, we've been married for 7. She said, what's the secret? And I had to think for a minute. I said, well, here's the secret. We don't seek the compromise. We don't look for compromises in our marriage. What we do is we seek to find out what is right. And then we give up our rights, our feelings, our preferences, our desires to what's right. When both people seek to do what's right, you don't really matter any longer. What does God say? Now, if I'm trying to follow God, cool. I'll never go wrong. But as long as I'm trying to follow God, I want God the way I want God to lead me. And I want Shirley to follow me in that direction. We're going to have troubles. We're going to bump heads. Oh, we made it 38 years, thank God, because we finally got it right where we're trying to follow God and not our own hearts. And I say that to say that when there is infidelity in the marriage, even though Jesus says you can divorce for that, he didn't say you should divorce for that. He didn't say you must. Because what the rest of the Bible tells us and what Jesus also says, if you don't forgive, then your Father in heaven won't forgive you. So if she cheats on me, I gotta forgive her. If I cheat on her, she's got to forgive me because we're not seeking our own. We're seeking what's right before God. And now again, that don't mean it won't be easy. But as long as we keep seeking what's right before God, we'll get there. We'll get there. Here's a very disturbing statistic. these last two. 74% of men said they would have an affair if they knew they would never get caught. It's not that much better for women. Because it was 68% of women who said they would have an affair if they knew they would never get caught. And I'm looking at some of the ladies' faces when I read that. They're like, huh? That's because you're in love with your husbands. You're in love with God, and you never want to hurt the heart of God. Remember again how God always characterized Israel when they stepped away from him as them being in an adulterous relationship? When we step away from the truth of God's word, when we step away from doing what's right, we're committing adultery against God, just like Israel did. That's deep, y'all. And that's the thing that keeps me. You say, well, you want to do it just because you love? No. It's not just because I love Sheila. It's because I love God more than I love Sheila. I don't want to hurt God's heart. And I know that might seem kind of rough to some of the ladies in here. You mean tell me you don't love her that much? I do love her that much, but I don't love her more than I love God. And I don't want her to love me more than she loves God. I had a preacher, a friend of mine, a young lady, and he was a preacher and she was married to him. And I think I mentioned this to y'all once before. She looked at me one day and told me, I divorced him because I loved him more than I loved God. I'm thinking to myself, how stupid of a statement. Because that's just a change of a direction and focus of your love. You don't get rid of your husband because you love him more than you love God. You just learn how to love God more than you love your husband. And so she gets remarried, he gets remarried, and according to Jesus, both of them were then living in adultery. Because it wasn't because of sexual impurities. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. As the old folks used to say, it's tight, but it's right. Help us, Lord, to honor our marriage vows. Flesh gets in the way. Emotions get in the way. Hormones get in the way. But your word, Lord, is life for us. It's alive. It's powerful. So help us, Lord, to immerse ourselves in your love, in your word, not just to be hearers of your word, not just to be recipients of your love, but to be doers of your word and to be sharers of your love. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.